Now that we've learned a bit about solutions and diffusion, let's talk about the plasma membrane, the boundary of the cell, the border between life and not life. So let's talk a bit about plasma membranes and how they work. Now, all cells have a plasma membrane. This is something that's shared both with prokaryotic cells and eukaryotic cells. And what this plasma membrane does is that it separates the cell from its environment. This plasma membrane serves as a selectively permeable barrier between two aqueous solutions, the cytoplasm or cytosol within the cell and the environment outside of the cell. Some biologically important molecules can be transported across the membrane. If they would otherwise be blocked by this barrier. So let's talk about what this barrier is made of. Now, primarily, the plasma membrane is a phospholipid bilayer. We talked about phospholipids in the last module. These were lipids that had a hydrophilic head. And hydrophobic tails. We call a molecule that's hydrophilic on one end and hydrophobic on the other amphipathic. So a phospholipid is an amphipathic molecule. And when you have a bunch of phospholipids together in an aqueous environment, they end up forming what's called a bilayer, where we have two layers of these phospholipids, all pointing their tails towards the middle of the membrane, while having the hydrophilic heads of the molecules pointing out towards where the water is. This type of a membrane poses a barrier to movement for large molecules and electrically charged molecules. In contrast, very small molecules like water, oxygen gas, and carbon dioxide, they're able to pass right through the plasma membrane. And even some larger hydrophobic molecules. Will not be blocked by a phospholipid bilayer. And this is because they can readily mix with the hydrophobic core of the phospholipid bilayer. And really, it's that hydrophobic core that's the barrier in a plasma membrane. What I'd like to do is briefly draw a diagram of a phospholipid bilayer. Now, keep in mind that there are aqueous solutions. Both outside and inside of the cell. The aqueous solution outside of the cell we call the cellular environment. And the aqueous solution inside the cell we refer to as the cytoplasm or cytosol. And so between these two aqueous solutions, we have a phospholipid bilayer. So with this phospholipid bilayer, the hydrophobic tails form the center of the membrane. And this is known as the hydrophobic core of the membrane. whereas the hydrophilic heads of the phospholipids are pointed towards both aqueous solutions, the water-based solution outside of the cell and the water-based solution inside of the cell. Now, occasionally, interspersed within this plasma membrane, we will have transport proteins. You can envision these transport proteins as being sort of barrel-shaped or tunnel-shaped. These transport proteins can allow larger molecules and hydrophilic molecules the ability to move into or out of the cell. Some of these transport proteins will also be very specific and only allow certain molecules to get through. Others will be gated, and so sometimes they'll be open and sometimes they'll be closed. Now, continuous, so just right on the other side of that transport protein, we're going to have more phospholipids. So here we have a diagram of the plasma membrane of a cell, a phospholipid bilayer with a transmembrane protein, in this case, a transport protein. This barrier allows certain molecules to pass through, but blocks others. Now, if you recall in the previous video, we learned about diffusion, that molecules move from areas of high concentration towards areas of low concentration. If the movement of these molecules is into or out of the cell, and it's done with the force of diffusion, we call this passive transport. Passive transport is when substances are moving with the force of diffusion into or out of the cell. Now, passive transport happens automatically. It requires no extra energy. Passive transport is always movement from an area of high concentration towards an area of low concentration. Now, you can almost think of diffusion being a force like a current, where it is possible to fight against a current in a large body of water, but it's going to take a lot of energy. It's going to take a lot of effort. If our cell wants to move something against the force of diffusion, it can do that. It's just going to take some energy. And this is known as active transport. Active transport is when substances are moving against the force of diffusion, into or out of a cell. Active transport requires added energy. Active transport is the movement of substances from a low concentration to a high concentration. Active transport will also generate a concentration gradient. So it produces a concentration gradient. Now, when we think about active and passive transport, another example that we might be familiar with is the effect of gravity. Let's say you have a large ball at the top of a hill. It doesn't take much effort to simply let that ball go. And have it roll all the way down to the bottom of the hill. However, if we want to get that ball back up the hill, we can do it, but it's going to take some effort. We're going to have to fight against the force of gravity. Well, diffusion is very similar. If you have a high concentration on one side of the membrane and low concentration on the other, diffusion is going to want to equalize those concentrations. Now, the cell can fight against that equalization. It can fight against diffusion. But it's going to require energy to pump molecules from a low concentration towards a high concentration. So what are the types of molecules that can pass through the plasma membrane? Well, small molecules. And hydrophobic ones are able to diffuse through membranes. The plasma membrane is permeable to these molecules. So they're simply going to move by way of diffusion from high concentration towards low concentration. Now, larger molecules and ions, which are electrically charged atoms or molecules, they cannot diffuse through the plasma membrane. Instead, they enter cells through protein carriers. Because they cannot pass through the plasma membrane on their own. These protein carriers include channel proteins and passive carriers. So in this diagram, we can see things like water, oxygen gas, and carbon dioxide. They can diffuse right through the plasma membrane. Channel proteins, they allow specific types of molecules, such as ions and water, to pass through, but sometimes these channel proteins will be gated, open occasionally, but also at other times closed. Ions, such as sodium and potassium, will sometimes pass through very specialized carrier proteins that, while similar to channel proteins, they still allow molecules to move with the force of diffusion. The shape is very specific, and only particular molecules can pass through them. So, looking at these two forms of diffusion, these are sometimes referred to as facilitated diffusion. So, channel proteins, they form water-filled tunnels across the plasma membrane. And passive carrier proteins, they are specific to the molecules being transported. Active transport are when molecules are pumped against the concentration gradient. Active carriers are transport proteins that use energy from ATP. You may remember we had mentioned ATP when we were discussing nucleic acids. They're actually a nucleotide, a nucleic acid monomer. The way these active carriers work is that energy changes the shape of the carrier, allowing molecules to pass from one side of the membrane to the other. You can almost think of this as an electrical pump actively pumping water, or in this case, pumping molecules against the force of diffusion. Active transport produces or maintains a concentration gradient. In this particular example, we're told that there's a low concentration of this red molecule outside of the cell, but the cell wants more, and it's willing to spend energy to get more. We're told there's a high concentration of this substance inside the cell, again, but the cell still wants more. So in its default or resting state, this active carrier is open to the outside of the cell. When one of these red molecules binds to it, a molecule of ATP within the cell will power the change in shape of this carrier protein. In this way, once that molecule is energized, it releases the transported molecule inside the cytoplasm. Once the phosphate group is released from this active carrier, it will revert back to its original shape, allowing it another one of those red molecules from outside of the cell to enter in. Now, if we look at a very specific example of this within our cells, there are sodium-potassium pumps. Now, there's a higher level of sodium outside of our cells than inside, and a lower concentration of potassium outside than inside. And yet, our cells want to get rid of the sodium that it has and pick up more potassium, even though it's already at a higher concentration within the cell. This is done through active transport. The active carrier proteins are able to pick up sodium ions from inside of the cell, and then when they're energized, they change shape and release those sodium ions outside of the cell. In that shape change, they now have binding sites for potassium, and as those potassium binding sites are filled, the molecule changes its shape again. The potassium is released internally, and more sodium can now bind to that binding site to be pumped out again. In this case, both sodium and potassium ions are being pumped against their concentration gradient. And really, all it's costing the cell to do this is energy. That's the end of this video. In the next video, we're going to talk about a very specific form of diffusion known as osmosis.